Very good morning to all of you. I'm Dr. Priya from Aravind Eye Hospital, Pondicherry. I thank you all for joining this session today and giving me this opportunity. My topic for discussion today is rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis and eye. Mucor is a ubiquitous fungi. The spores are found everywhere. It can also be part of our commensal. Though infection due to mucor is rare, it is not new to the ophthalmologist or ENT community. We usually see them among patients with uncontrolled diabetes and patients on immunosuppressants. The incidence in India is around 0.16%, which is slightly higher when compared to other countries. It is called black fungus not because of the pigmentation, but because of tissue discoloration it produces due to necrosis. Now the pressing question is, why the surge all across the country, particularly among patients who have recovered from COVID? There are various speculations, starting from the pathogenesis of COVID itself, which causes breakdown of the epithelial barrier in nose and the sinuses. The viral load can result in lymphopenia and cytokine surge, creating a prothrombotic state that can be conducive for the growth of the virus. It is also speculated that COVID-19 can induce hyperglycemia even in patients without diabetes, or it can aggravate existing hyperglycemia, thus affecting neutrophil functioning. Of all these speculations, the strongest association is found between diabetes and mucormycosis. So as the blood sugar increases and goes beyond a critical point, it results in glycosylation of proteins like transferrin and ferritin. This glycosylation impairs the ability of transferrin to chelate iron. As a result, the blood level of free iron increases. Now, why is it a concern to us when the iron level increases? It is because the fungal acquisition of free iron supports growth of hyphal forms. So this results in enhancing the fungal growth. Now, why is it urgent to treat mucormycosis? It is because the survival outcomes are directly dependent on the time of intervention. So at the late stages of the disease, when there is CNS involvement, the mortality can be as high as 80%. Now, who are all at risk? So all patients who have recovered from COVID or who have active COVID infection, should they be concerned about developing mucormycosis? The answer is no. So patients who have been managed in ICU and have received ventilatory support, patients with uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, patients who have been covered with steroids for COVID-19 management, patients who received oxygen for a prolonged duration, and patients receiving immunosuppressants for a pre-existing illness are more at risk. Now, one or more of these risk factors, when they come together, then it becomes a deadly triad. Now, commonest symptoms with which the patient presents include headache or facial pain, pain and swelling in the eye, double vision, nasal block, sinusitis or discharge that can usually be blackish or brownish or blood tinged, loose tooth or toothache, and black or brown deposits in nasal mucosa and the palate. The commonest presenting signs include ptosis, proptosis, ophthalmoplegia, palatal and lid eschars, central retinal artery and vein occlusions. Now the preferred mode of investigation for confirmation of diagnosis is MRI orbits, paranasal sinuses and brain, preferably with contrast, nasal endoscopy, potassium hydroxide wet mount, and tissue for fungal culture sensitivity after debridement. Now, contrast enhanced MRI is preferred over CT because only a MRI shows whether the affected tissue is necrosed or still vascularized. In other words, only MRI can demarcate between the viable and the non-viable tissue. We can see this with an example. So this is the CT and MRI of the same patient. So in the CT, we can see the area of involvement. So here we are seeing the nasal cavity and the sinuses being involved, but we do not know whether the tissue involved is still viable or it is already necrosed. Whereas if you see the MRI, Here we are seeing the area of demarcation. So here clearly represents necrosis. So this is called black turbinate sign, and it is a sign of danger. Also, MRI helps us in deciding the line of management, like whether the particular patient requires invasive destructive surgeries like excentration, which is a very radical procedure, or whether would debridement alone would suffice. So here we can see the involvement of the nasal cavity sinuses and orbital involvement. So even though the medial orbit is involved, the muscles are still taking up contrast. It means the muscles have preserved their vascularization and the muscles are still viable. So in this case, they need not go for an excentration, but a debridement primarily done by the ENT surgeon themselves would suffice. And so MRI, that is contrast enhanced, involving the orbit, paranasal sinuses and brain, is the ideal investigation of choice for mucormycosis. Moving on to the staging of mucormycosis, we are presenting a very simplified version of the staging. So stage one is when the infection is confined to the nasal cavity, and here the sinuses are spared. So in stage two, there is extension into the paranasal sinuses. Stage three has involvement of orbit. So in 3A and 3B, there is no vision loss, but once it crosses stage 3C, there can be unilateral or bilateral sudden loss of vision. So in stage 3C, there is orbital apex involvement, and in 3D, there is bilateral orbital involvement. And in stage four, so we can see the sinuses being involved, the nasal cavity sinuses, the orbit, the infection extending to the orbital apex and into the cavernous sinus. So this is when the mortality increases to more than 80%. So the broad management guidelines, all patients are to be started with liposomal amphotericin B, 5 to 10 milligram per kilogram per day for 2 weeks. Dual therapy can be initiated by adding oral posaconazole 300 mg BD for the first day, followed by 300 mg OD for 2 weeks in addition to the liposomal amphotericin. And the dual therapy can be continued till there is clinical resolution and radiological stabilization in all patients. Surgical management, early surgical debridement of sinuses is indicated in all patients so that it can prevent spread. And transcutaneous retrobulbar amphotericin B is indicated only in select cases. Orbital excentration is indicated in stages beyond 3B or when there is rapid progression of the disease from one stage to another in less than 72 hours. Now, moving on to the prevention of rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis. At this point, the way to go about mucormycosis is prevention and early detection. Because amidst a crisis, adding on to the non-availability of drugs and care, the emotional and financial blow to these patients can be devastating. So the first and foremost point in prevention is aggressive monitoring and control of blood sugar. So monitor blood sugar levels post-COVID-19 discharge. So this has to be emphasized to all patients because this is the most important weak link through which the fungus can invade. So once patients recover from COVID-19, they enter into a relaxed zone where they do not pay attention to their blood sugars. At the same time, their food habits also are in the line of nourishing and recovering them, which might often be high in sugars. For example, they are given more fruit juices or health drinks, which are naturally high in sugars. So patients have to be educated and emphasized and warned that uncontrolled blood sugar can literally be a life killer. So by addressing this, so we can stop the domino effect by the virus, which can unfortunately end or culminate in mucormycosis. So the deadly triad, like we saw the risk factors before, when two or more of the risk factors come together, the commonest and the most deadly being a patient with diabetes who has been affected by COVID-19 and who has received steroids enters a state of hyperglycemia. and ketoacidosis. COVID-19 itself, apart from hyperglycemia, can also result in increased ferritin levels. This is because ferritin is also an inflammatory marker. So when COVID-19 induces infection and inflammation, there is an increase in cytokines, an increase in ferritin. So the increase in ferritin results in increased intracellular iron, which increases the reactive oxygen species, and it results in an environment that is conducive for the growth of the fungus. So it is also stated, even though we don't have much evidence, it is also stated that patients who are given zinc supplement for viral infection should be avoided or asked not to take combinations that contain iron, because already their intracellular iron and ferritin levels are high. The next important preventive aspect is the barrier. So this pertains to the adornment of hygienic mask covering the nose and the mouth. So patients have to be educated on the do's and don'ts of wearing a mask. So they should be advised to maintain social distance even when wearing a mask. Wash hands before putting on a mask and immediately after removing. And even if they've recovered, they should still be advised to continue wearing masks even at home. So this helps to slow the spread of the virus if they are still shedding. And cloth masks should be laundered after each use. The don'ts that have to be emphasized includes: do not wear mask below nose, under chin, or with gaps on the sides. Minimal touch or handling of the mask while wearing it. Do not wear a face mask if wet or if it contains spit or mucus. Do not touch your eyes, nose, and mouth when removing your face mask. And the most important point that has to be stressed and re-emphasized is: do not reuse surgical masks or unwashed cloth masks, because they themselves can be a surface medium providing place for growth of the fungus, which can further invade into the nasal cavity and spread beyond. Corticosteroids is a double-edged sword. So starting steroids at the very early stage of the infection can itself increase the viral replication and cause worsening of the disease. But at the same time, if it is not given at the right time, if indicated, like in a cytokine storm, then it can also prove to be fatal. So judicious and supervised use of systemic steroids is mandatory. So it's better to avoid steroids in COVID-19 patients if their oxygen saturation is above 94 and respiratory rate is less than 24 per minute, rather than starting steroids for all patients with COVID-19, which is currently being practiced in many places. Drugs like tocilizumab should be used as per guidelines. It's an interleukin-6 inhibitor and it reduces the inflammatory manifestations associated with severe COVID-19 infection. But it has a set of ill effects. It is not advised to people who are already immunocompromised. There is increased risk of developing serious infections, and patients should be monitored for hypersensitivity reactions and also be monitored for development of tuberculosis. In addition to this, it's also speculated that tocilizumab can cause immune suppression, thereby leading to secondary fungal and bacterial infections. We must ensure strict aseptic measures while administering oxygen. So use of distilled or sterile water is preferred for the humidification of oxygen, and tap water must not be used. Another reason that is stated is the rising use of the industrial grade oxygen in place of medical grade oxygen due to non-availability. We do not have enough evidence about this yet, but this is also an important point to be considered. So another important checkpoint where we can catch this disease at the early stage itself is by doing nasal endoscopic assessment by the ENT residents for high-risk patients after a week of treatment at the time of discharge and also a week after discharge. So this will help us to identify these patients at the early stage itself, and patients will also be instilled with an awareness for what to look for and to maintain their blood sugars adequately. For high-risk patients, we can consider prophylactic oral posaconazole. This is in fact being given already in countries like UK. So the final point for prevention which we would like to put forward is gargling of mouth with Betadine twice a day. Even though a simple measure, it can significantly improve health among patients vulnerable for mucormycosis. So a patient who has recently recovered from COVID-19 infection, when he is diagnosed with mucormycosis, the tunnel is often long and dark, and unfortunately, not many times he sees light at the end of the tunnel. So what do we do to take him out or show him the light? It is prevention or early detection. So this is the only way to grow forward to prevent this crisis and make our area and our community free of mucormycosis. Thank you.